My name is Lino Grandi. I've been working with Lightway for more than 25 years now. So I started when, you know, it was really an embryo. Now it's grown up and it's a very cool application. And now I work for the Lightway 3D Group since 4 years for NewTek and the Lightway 3D Group as a content creator mainly. So every time we release a new Lightwave, I build the content to show the new features. So please go through them, and you can learn something from that. And yeah, I also responsible of Genoma, which is the rigging system. You can find Lightwave since 11.5, and. Yeah, so again, I'm so excited to be here because this kind of events are going to really make Lightway shine, and students are very important for us because a 3D software lets you build your dream. So that's the most important thing. So let's start with our first guest, which is Jonathan Elenskis from Darkside Animation. Darkside Animation, it's a Lightway 3D based studio. It's in UK and has produced a lot of very cool visual effects for several TV shows. And yeah, so Jonathan is going to tell us to how Lightway enables them to to do live action integration, and it will discuss several aspects of the VFX industry and the lighter role for the artist. So, Jonathan Elenskis.
How do I get this?
I think it's you're okay.
Hello? Is that working? Okay. Hi guys, how you doing? This is the first time I'm doing a demo, so I've kept it quite simple, and I want to talk about very core points about what you need to do to be able to deliver a job. Okay, so I've been using Lightway since 2000, and I started in VFX, and then I went into character animation. Then I worked on set a lot for a few years, and then I came back into visual effects again. So I think I managed to get quite a good feel, for on-set cameras, how things really work outside, and bringing it back in. And I joined Darkside last year. Darkside's been running since 2000, and they've been using Lightwave right since then. They've just found that Lightwave really is a good product for being able to get good work out. And most of the work is TV. So fast turnarounds, and really Lightwave does help us do that. So I put myself in a hot seat. Mostly what I'm going to do is demo, just kind of the process of going through a project. As a Lightwave artist, you're probably going to be a generalist when you go out and get a job somewhere, or if you start your own business at home or work as a freelancer. You need to be a generalist. So it's very important to try and understand all the areas. Get a camera, go out and shoot things, learn compositing, learn editing, because that's the kind of artist you're gonna have to be, and to be a good generalist. Okay, so I also don't work on Macs. I'm a Macophobe, and this is gonna be interesting. Right. A lot of people, a lot of artists that I get sort of jump straight in and just open up the package and start, being creative and trying things and that. And sometimes that causes a problem. My advice is, this is why I say learn compositing. I think you need to start by setting your workflow up at the beginning and getting things running smoothly. And once you've got all the technical work out of the way, that is when you start getting creative, and you use any time that you've got left on a job being creative. Right. So. Okay. All right. At the beginning of the job, when you pick up a job for VFX, it's usually live action integration, and then some shots are all CG. But most of the time, we're looking at getting plates and just putting something in. So you're going to deal with getting footage in, which can get quite confusing sometimes. I've got a plate here, which is shot on a RED camera. And it's either going to happen in one way. You're going to work directly with the filmmakers or cinematographer, and they're going to hand you the files from their camera, okay? So, like, I've got a RED file. Or if you're working with a small facility or a proper DI or color grader, you're going to get DPX or EXR, okay? DPX being the most common. And those are the formats you're going to start working with. And it's very important to get color space all the way through. Years ago, I've been involved in many jobs where you work so hard, and you get right to the end, and you deliver your product, and then you get a phone call from the post-production suite saying, oh, the colors don't match, this is all wrong, fix it. And you have to start again. So you don't want to end in that situation, and that's why I'm quite thorough in this part. My advice for the best workflow is when you get it in, so I've got a RED file, I've created an After Effects project, which I've called IO, so it's my in-out project. And over here, it's just an 8-bit comp, and there's no working spaces, it's not linearized, it's just a straight comp, like when you open After Effects. Then you pull in your source, and you put that source on a timeline, and then you render that out. That's not how you do it on a Mac. Where's the render view? Windows render. Cute. Render it out, get your settings, and choose OpenEXR. Okay? So really the safest way, I've tried it all kinds of directions. I've gone out as DPXs, I've gone out in sRGB, I've gone out in linear. This is the safest way. There is one or two ways to design your workflow, but I'd recommend you get everything, especially if you're going into 3D and then back into comp, put it in a linear format, so put it into EXR. So I set that as EXR, and I render it out. That is now the plate which I'm going to use to do my work, not the original file handed to me. So once I've output that, okay, I'll import it. So here's the one that I exported before from the RED file. I just rendered out as EXR. If I bring that back in and I put it over the R3D, okay, and that's a bigger control. There's a size change, but this, I'll tell you why that is now. But the colors aren't changing, and that's the most important thing, okay? You don't want to see any color shift happening at all. The reason the size was changing is when I drag the footage in, this is very important. The first thing you do is you find out what you're delivering to your client. So this RED file shot at 6K, okay? It's important to find out how you're delivering it. I'm assuming I'm not delivering to a place that's playing at 6K. And so the client tells me, no, it's going to be 1920 by 1080, yeah, HD, full, great. And that's where I render it out. And I'm still getting a color shift here. I'll sort that out later. Oh, I see that. But you're looking for no color shift. That's the most important part. LUTs. Often, when you've been handed the footage, you're also going to get handed a LUT file that goes with it. If you're working with a facility, if you're working on very small projects, you're often not going to get a LUT file. But it's also good to test it here again. This is where I test everything. Okay, so I've got a LUT, and that's what it needs to look like. So I've got a compare file. This is my R3D I originally exported. That's my EXR. There's no shift. DPX out, this is a test render I did, and we'll come back to that. And I've got a LUT on top, okay? And so now I know that I've got in and out fine. So that EXR is what I'm going to use in Lightwave. Okay, on set you've seen supervisors, visual effects guys with chrome balls and white shiny balls and matte gray diffuse balls, and that's to catch the lighting of the scene. And on smaller productions you often don't get that stuff. But even so, what I still do when I start creating a scene is I set up the environment, and that is the first thing that I bring in is an object that I've set up with like a chrome ball surface, a shiny white specular one, and a diffuse gray matte ball. Because that tells me a lot about if the environment is set up correctly and if everything's projecting well. Now, this is a typical case on a small film where actually all I got was the plate. I didn't get HDR eyes. I didn't get any reference material, and this is a, you know, quite a tricky situation if you're trying to integrate something. So what I'm going to do quickly is I'm going to attempt to rebuild that. I think that this is the most important part, really. It's just setting things up and getting it right in the beginning. For color space, we want to work in a linear color space. But we want to see things in sRGB. That's how our monitor displays it. That's how I want to see it, but I want it to calculate in a linear space. For color pickers, sometimes use what you prefer, what you're picking your colors from. But lights must be linear, 8-bit float linear, float files obviously linear, and view it in sRGB. And I'm going to render out EXR, so that's why I'm in output linear. Okay. Okay. Right. So when I bring this in, drop it in my backdrop. I need to go look at my camera settings, match those. Let's turn on DPR. All right, let me show you. If I go to all linear. This is all linear. This is when you open Lightwave for the first time. If you don't change your color spaces, this is what you're seeing. And it's really hard to work like that. You want to view it correctly, right? So that's why we pop it over to sRGB, okay? And then file load objects. I've got a folder in my projects called utility where I keep things that like the HDR balls that I bring in. So that's, I've always just got it ready. And a predator head, because that's quite cool. It's nice to have a bust in there, so you can see how light forms around faces and things. It just tells you a lot about the scene. So I usually just pop that further back. Grab the ground and look at the balls. It's really difficult working on the mat. What did I do? I need help from a Mac person, please. I've got nothing on my screen here. Just need to see the screen. Building those packs of things to work with, like HDR balls, having default nice Tyler ball textured images in your images folder, having all those things ready is very helpful when you need to move fast. You don't have to always go and find it or create it or make it. So I just keep those as defaults, so it allows me to get through my scene quickly. Thank you. Okay. Okay, so I've brought in my back plate, I've brought in these objects, and now I can start setting the environment to light properly. So I don't have an HDR, but I'm going to use the plate that's been shot to light it. Ambient intensity, always get that off. And I'll turn off the light for now. If I go to textured environment and I bring the back plate that I've loaded into there and put it spherical and go to my render settings and enable radiosity, it's now going to be using that plate to light it. You've all done this before, yeah, in your studies. So this is where these balls tell me if things are working well. Once I'm happy, okay, this is great, but it looks like it needs a bit more lights. So then you can turn your lights on and start matching light sources, and or enhancing the lighting so that your subject looks good. But this is the quickest way to start setting it up. So I'm going to show you the scene that I've done. Just continuing from this point, I put a shadow cast object for the floor, so that it can catch the shadows of objects in the scene, and I also brought in a helicopter object and this little flying kind of like a drone. I'm going to talk about the materials that I've got in here quickly. So we set up lighting. What I've got is exactly the same wraparound I used before, except that because we've shot it from this angle, wrapping that round, stretching it a lot, and you're not going to get nice reflections overhead down onto the objects. So what you can do is take that image into Photoshop, or even in After Effects, you can kind of start attacking this. And I'll show you what I did with it. Oh, there we go. So I took that image, tiled it up, gave it more space in the top, and just cloned things and painted out. So this is now serving as my wraparound environment, and that's going to help give it at least a better feel for reflections, and you know, not getting scenes or a stretched image wrapped around it. So that's what I'm going to be. That's what I'm using now. On the balls, I'm using node shaders. I pretty much don't use the layer shading system anymore. I always work in the nodes and use the materials. And some of the speakers later will be going into a lot more detail on this. But I try and keep things as simple as possible so I don't get caught up early on in all of that. So for the chrome ball, I'm just using a conductor, and I'm using a Fresnel plugged in to the specular channel. The gray diffuse ball, I'm using a Delta with a Fresnel, with a different Fresnel setting. That's good for like a plastic, and it's got a roughness applied to it, which blurs the reflection on the surface. And these are really good materials. That are here in the nodes. So I suggest that you start utilizing them. Use Delta and Conductor and the dielectric, and use Fresnels, and start building your shader networks from there. My default objects also just got some points that I can tie materials to for later. And when I start importing my models, the first thing I'll do is I'll go get the white specular ball, the one that we see over here. I'll grab that material and pop it onto my objects, or if it's a metal object, I'll just grab the chrome and paste it on, so I can very quickly get a surface which works nicely onto all the objects. From this point, I'm just gonna go out and open it here. We can start texturing. What I like to do is, for texturing, I have a scene with a daylight, a proper HDRI, because in the example I just showed you on that shot, you're not 100% sure if that wraparound environment, how realistic it's working, or if it's working correctly. So I like to have a baseline scene. So I've got this HDR from Illuminated Tools, I think it's the website, and I have that same basic scene in there, and this is a scene that I use for texturing, because I pretty much, you have a really good sense of what things look like in a daylight, slightly overcast scene, or a daylight scene, and you can also find a lot of photo reference usually. So a scene like this, for me, is where I will come, bring in my objects and start texturing outside of the other scene that I've been building. So I'll get everything looking like they belong in the real world in this scene. And then everything has a baseline of how it looks, how it's surfaced, how it's textured. And that then goes into my scenes I build from backplates. And if it looks wrong, it's more than likely not that my texturing or my surfacing is wrong, it's that my lighting and my environment setup is wrong, and I need to improve that section so I can focus on where the problems might be. So I'll go in here and I might then turn the things off and bring in an object. So let's get that little drone. So if I've just modeled this, I'll bring him in, and this is where I'll start setting up the materials. So for example, like I said earlier, if those blades are to be metal, I've got a chrome, but I'll just go here and I'll paste it on, and you know, maybe you want something chrome, and if I don't, then I can just go in and start messing with the settings that I've got, and create different looking materials, and start applying textures, whatever you want to do. And you get it until it looks real in here or matches your reference photography, and then export it. The next step is obviously going back to your scene that you set up, and pulling your textured objects and assets in, which I, you know, I've got here. Oh, I don't have there. What I did in this scene, you can see those pillars at the back. I lined those up to the pillars in the scene and used a front projection node from the camera. And the reason I did that is if you've got reflective objects moving and flying through the scene, the reflections or the shadows cast by objects in the scene will be apparent. Or if you have the colors of objects in the scene, the radiosity solution will affect those objects in a more realistic way. So I'll map the set out as much as I can, pull in my objects, get the animation done, and then I'm looking at a scene which is kind of at a first pass level. This is something I can now render the sequence out. How am I on time, anyone? Almost there, yeah? So I like rendering with Mitchell. 8 samples was enough to get a result out of this scene. That was good enough. I don't even use the adaptive sampling. And I'm using the photoreal motion blur settings because it's not a big scene. It's quite quick to get out. And I've rendered this out. So going back to After Effects quickly to look at the end of the shot. I took the plate and did a little bit of cleanup on it. If you remember before, it had some stuff in the foreground, so I've just done a quick bit of cleanup. I've rendered a shadow pass. I broke the scene into a shadow pass. A tip from me is don't use a black and white shadow pass and just lay that over and call it as a multiply. It's not a really good look for shadows. Don't just multiply them over. Use it as a matte pass for a grade node. And actually, if you can see what's happening there, grade your shadows in, because it just looks a lot more beautiful and actually matches the shadows in the real plate. Then we've got the helicopter in a pass. Now that's all procedural. So this is where, on my first pass of a shot, what I'm trying to do is get what I need to get into the scene in and picking colors that are correct, making sure the lighting's right. And this as a first pass, I'll say, okay, that's the shot. That's what it's going to be like. We've still got more work to do on the helicopter, and we actually need to texture it. This is just a procedural and a bit of a tiled image for the rusty parts of the metal. But it's just to get an idea of the shot. And then the hero of the shot is this drone character who flies around the scene. I use Spline Control for that. Spline Control has been really handy since it's come out. I've used that on a load of projects. So he's animated going around, and of course I've just done a little bit of color adjustment. I did some color adjustment on the glass. It's very hard to see there, just to make it feel a bit more dusty. And I've done rotors for the poles so that the drone flies in front and behind them. And importantly, at the end, I've got a LUT on top, so I can check that my colors are working with the LUT, the colors of my CG, because sometimes grades and LUTs, they're really strong, and they might influence one color more than you think. And you do the shot, it looks great without the color grade, and when they apply the grade in DI, it just doesn't look that good. So if you can get their grade, you want to see what it looks like, so you know what your CG is going to look like in the end. And then when I render this out, so we've taken it from whatever you received. If you received the camera movie file, the red R3D file, the DPX, whatever you received, we've taken that, we've turned it into EXR, we've put EXR into Lightwave, and we've built our composite using EXR, so we can comp in a linear space, and the colors don't change in Lightwave when they go in, when they come out, when they go into your comp. There's no color change, everything sits properly. Then we render this out. Don't render a movie out as your final project. Render out an image sequence. So you can either render out an EXR and then convert that to what your client wants. Remember I said earlier, find out what you're delivering right in the beginning. And you design everything based on that. So if they wanted 1920, 1080, 25 frames per second, DPX, right? I know that, so I can keep that in mind with everything I do along the way. And at the end, I can render out here as a DPX. So I've selected, you know, DPX is going back. They gave me DPX, I made it EXR, I did my work. Now I'm sending back DPX. And in color management, because I'm compositing with EXR files, I'm working in a linear sRGB space. So I need to choose that space on my way out as well, because that's something that can also change the color on the way out. Set my content, render it out, and then last thing you do before you give it to your client, open that project you made earlier, your IO project, which has no color space, no linearization. Bring in the shot that you rendered, the DPX, bring it in and check that there's no color shifting and no changes. And then if that's working well, then you can send that through to your client. And this is where I'd suggest you look at getting your work for a first pass. And from here, you make it better. You spend a lot of time texturing, painting beautiful maps, tweaking the comp a little, making everything that you can better. This doesn't take long to, like, making this scene. If you've got the assets, this is half an hour to an hour of work to get everything right and know that everything works properly. And then use the rest of your time making it the best work that you possibly can. I think that's all I've got to work through today.